Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. It is a joy for me today because we have a very, very special guest, Howard Charing. Thank you, Howard, for coming here. You are co-author of two best-selling books. The first one, which was translating in the Romanian, it's Plant Spirit Shamanism, mm-hmm. in 2006, yeah. And the other one, it's the Ayahuasca Visions of Pablo Amaringo in 2011.
That's correct.
You are an accomplished international workshop leader in shamanism. And you was working with some of extraordinary shamans and healers in the Andes, in the Amazon rainforest, and also in Philippines.
That's correct, yeah.
Yes, I think it was an adventurous period of your life to be there and to feel the Amazon rainforest and all this ancient culture, and it is not very often for us to go there. So can you share with us something from the rich experience that you have had in?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, I'll just go back slightly to give it some context. You know, back in 1982, I had a 1983. I had an accident. I was in an elevator crash.
Oh.
And in that, had a serious accident, broken neck and broken back, and so on, and a near death experience. You know, it was there's a long story involved in this, but. Mm-hmm. You know, I did survive, but the experience changed my life. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, it wasn't as if I was consciously thinking, my life has changed, mm-hmm. but the aftermath of the accident, I wasn't, you know, I had couldn't orthopedic collar, and I couldn't walk properly, couldn't stand up properly, and so on. I was kind of forced to reevaluate my life, you know, mm-hmm. look at my life, and so on. Mm-hmm. And all sorts of experiences started to happen from this. Mm-hmm. And my interest went on to kind of trying to find a reference for it, trying to find a framework for it, trying to put it into some kind of context, which I couldn't mm-hmm. do mm-hmm. in my everyday life. And I was mm-hmm. I was a manager in American Computer Corporation at the time, mm-hmm. and the kind of the world of the shaman, traditional healing and knowledge and medicine and so on was never part of this. Mm-hmm. And but the accident really, once I recovered, took me 3 years to kind of get it together again, which is another story.
3 years.
3 years. Oh, yeah. Yeah. 3 years before I was physically okay again, you know, mm-hmm. and I was very lucky. Mm-hmm. And I had to really kind of rethink my life, you know, mm-hmm. and things which had meaning for me before, which felt had meaning, mm-hmm. no longer had meaning. Mm-hmm. So I became a seeker. I was seeking for the truth. I wasn't seeking for the truth. Mm-hmm. I was just trying to find something to connect to, because my mm-hmm. life had become unanchored. You know, like we have our lives, you know, we have an anchor in our lives, you know? Mm-hmm. We do our work, we have our family, we have friends, mm-hmm. we have activities and interests. They are kind of an anchor in the cultural context, mm-hmm. but my anchors were destroyed, you know, just gone. And so I started getting involved in kind of traditional knowledge and medicine and shamanism and so on. Mm-hmm. And there's one thing reading the book about somebody's experiences, mm-hmm. somebody's input, somebody's kind of mm-hmm. stories and so on, mm-hmm. but you know, the only thing you really can do is to have your own experience, mm-hmm. is to experience it for yourself. Mm-hmm. And I was starting to get very interested in Amazonian plant medicines and mm-hmm. ayahuasca and the ancient knowledge and so on, because mm-hmm. in particularly South America, why in Peru?
Mm-hmm.
I'll talk about Peru. Why Peru? You know, because Peru, you know, there's only had 500 years of institutionalized domination from the conquistadors, mm-hmm. and the missionaries in the Catholic Church, mm-hmm. and they had a huge they found the traditional medicine ways mm-hmm. and knowledge as to be pagan and terrible and work of the mm-hmm. devil and so on and mm-hmm. so forth, and they started to change it and started to shift mm-hmm. it. But 500 years isn't long enough
to eradicate
a traditional mm-hmm. knowledge, mm-hmm. traditional medicine, and traditional ways.
Luckily,
it's not
for
enough.
Us.
I mean, mm-hmm. you know, in fact, what's happened the other way around? It's like been a synthesis of kind of the traditional Catholic doctrine mm-hmm. and the traditional kind of Andean ways. They're kind of merged, and mm-hmm. this kind of the two have kind of become mm-hmm. very, very much mm-hmm. intermingled. Mm-hmm. But in our culture, certainly mm-hmm. 2,000 years mm-hmm. is long enough to
eradicate the roots. Yes.
Although it hasn't really completely eradicated, there's still pockets here and there in kind of a lot of folk knowledge and so on. Mm-hmm. But to eradicate as a vibrant force, mm-hmm. Traditional knowledge, medicine, and a connection with the living planet. And now, mm-hmm. see, we live in a kind of a world where the spirit, for want of a better word, the spirit mm-hmm. or consciousness mm-hmm. has been taken out of the world, you know, mm-hmm. and it's in our basic mythology, you know, mm-hmm. Man has been given dominion over all living things. We're at mm-hmm. the top of the food chain mm-hmm. and so on and so forth, and everything's there for our benefit and so on. Mm-hmm. And that is and that's such an antithesis mm-hmm. to the traditional ways where mm-hmm. humans are not at the top of the food chain.
Yes.
We do not have dominion over living things. Mm-hmm. We live mm-hmm. in a relationship mm-hmm. with all other living, mm-hmm. all beings, the planet and so on. Mm-hmm. They're in a harmony with this. Mm-hmm. The earth is not just an industrial resource to be mined, mm-hmm. to be exploited and so mm-hmm. on and so forth. So they have a very, very different kind of understanding and relationship. Mm-hmm. And that's what attracted me as well. Mm-hmm. And it's not just from a book. This is how it was done. It was still mm-hmm. being practiced. People mm-hmm. still go out to in the Andes, for example. They still go up to the hills and the mountains and make an offering to the consciousness or the spirit of that particular place. Mm-hmm. You know, they identify, they connect with this, and so mm-hmm. on and so forth. And they function as if there is an intelligence, there is a kind of a consciousness mm-hmm. within the living world, within plants, within mountains, within animals, and so on mm-hmm. and so forth. Non-human, but still a consciousness mm-hmm. which we need to be in relationship with. Mm-hmm. And that's what has been lost in the West.
Yes.
And I had an interest, a desire to kind of experience that. And mm-hmm. that's what really drew me out, not just read mm-hmm. about it, mm-hmm. you know, but, you know, partake of it, participate mm-hmm. in this. Mm-hmm. And that was the main thing. And that's what really drew me out to Peru, to the mm-hmm. Amazon, to the Andes. But I felt a particular all I can explain was I arrived in the rainforest in the Amazon, and it felt as if I wasn't literally, but it felt as I was hit by a bolt of lightning. Mm-hmm. You know, boom. Mm-hmm. And I feel with so much energy that I didn't need to sleep for 2 or 3 days. I didn't sleep. I was just full of this thing and so on. And I started to explore, and I like to try things. I like to, it's an adventure. Mm-hmm. You know, something new, something different, and so on. Mm-hmm. And I built up my own kind of reference, my own understanding through observation, through participation, and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. I've had a lot of interviews, a lot of contact with shamans and mm-hmm. people who work with the plant medicine and so on. And the relationship is what I'm talking about. That is the most important thing. You know, mm-hmm. the plant is not just an inanimate thing, a thing, you know, mm-hmm. it has a consciousness and so on. And that is the basis, that appreciation, that life has a consciousness, mm-hmm. non-human consciousness, but has mm-hmm. a consciousness that is different from the Western system. Mm-hmm. And that was really what kind of drew me in and got me involved and so on. And when through following these practices mm-hmm. which enable a person mm-hmm. to engage with this consciousness of this mm-hmm. other consciousness mm-hmm. and so on, then you experience it for yourself. You know, then you know it's valid mm-hmm. because you've had a subjective experience. Mm-hmm. And I do not want to diminish in any way the subjective, because at the end of the day, the final mm-hmm. analysis, everything is subjective. You know,
yes.
So mm-hmm. the objective subjective thing doesn't really play a role in this. Mm-hmm. And so that was really drew me in. You know, just mm-hmm. But the accident, my
accident
had to happen. That was the shift, which made me change, because mm-hmm. you know, my former life became no anchor. Mm-hmm. There was nothing there, no, the gravity wasn't there anymore, you know. Mm-hmm. So that propelled me to change and so on.
Yes, the anchor we need very much to find the original connection with the universe, and particularly with the plants. It is remarkable. I read in your books that, for example, ayahuasca it's speaking to us, and it's calling us, it's choosing us, the ayahuasca. And this is an important shift of perspective. And my rational mind, my Cartesian mind, always said, what is this? This is a plant, this is a thing, and not an entity. Yes.
Yeah.
And I need maybe an experience, as you have, in order to know, to experience in an empirical way that the plants have a spirit.
Yeah, you know, it's not for me to say what you need or don't need. I need to make that very, very clear. It's not for me. Mm-hmm. That's not for me at all. Mm-hmm. It's for you, mm-hmm. your intuition, your feeling, mm-hmm. your consciousness, your spirit, and so on. Something maybe in your heart, a feeling, mm-hmm. not a rational thought so much, mm-hmm. because that really doesn't play a role in this, but the feelings play a role. If you feel drawn, if you feel connected to, attracted to participation in this kind of work, then I would go along with that, because mm-hmm. that is the calling. It speaks to our mm-hmm. feelings, to our you know, our kind of how we feel, how we connect, and so on. Not so much the rational, logical, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. you know, kind of mind.
It came through my mind to ask you, can you share with us a moment when you meet in an empirical way the spirit of a plant? When you felt for the first time that it's something there, which is can be amazing for the rational mind.
Well, you know, it's subjective, yeah. I'm not saying this is the way. This mm-hmm. is how it's done. Mm-hmm. So everybody kind of connects in different ways. But the first thing to do is normally. Apart, see, the first thing is to have the intention, the desire, mm-hmm. not just the desire, mm-hmm. but have a good attitude towards the plants.
A good attitude.
Yeah, for a start, you can't say, well, the plants are just things, and they're just things, and just mm-hmm. green, or whatever, mm-hmm. you know. You have to have a feeling for the plants, yeah? You have to like the plants, mm-hmm. yeah? If you're someone, a person, I'm not saying you are, but if you're a person who doesn't like plants in the house, doesn't want flowers and things, then I'll say, don't bother with this, mm-hmm. yeah? If you're a person who likes having... being in parks, mm-hmm. being near trees, connected to plants and mm-hmm. flowers and things, mm-hmm. and like having plants around you. Yeah, I mean, that's the message there already, you know? Mm-hmm. You're ready. You're mm-hmm. not saying you like plants in your house from logical, rational mm-hmm. Perspective. You mm-hmm. you like plants in the house because mm-hmm. they make you feel good, make you feel comfortable, there's something nice about them. That's the feeling you go with, that mm-hmm. kind of attitude. No, the feeling attitude. Now, to really directly experience the consciousness of the plants is not 1, 2, 3. It's not straightforward. It's not mm-hmm. something that you can mm-hmm. just go and do. I'm going to talk to the plants, blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. You have to quiesce, turn down the volume mm-hmm. of your animal, monkey, primate mm-hmm. appetites. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have to become less primate. Yeah, mm-hmm. and this is in the food we eat, in the social contact and company. Mm-hmm. In some respects, you can see, I know it's a very crude analogy, but you can see humans as monkeys, you know, mm-hmm. monkeys. I mean, mm-hmm. Monkeys, we socialize, we interact with each other, we stimulate each other and so on, and all the other monkey things we do. You have to kind of quiesce that down. You have mm-hmm. to kind of become less mm-hmm. primate-like. Mm-hmm. And you know what people like, humans like? Humans like social contact, mm-hmm. like sexual contact, libidinous activities and so mm-hmm. on, like mm-hmm. stimulating mm-hmm. activities mm-hmm. and so on, stimulating food and things. Mm-hmm. That is what you have to kind of eliminate, quiesce. Mm-hmm. And as you kind of quiesce mm-hmm. these animal appetites in mm-hmm. many respects, you kind of automatically mm-hmm. become more plant-like. Mm-hmm. You move closer to the plants mm-hmm. by becoming less animal, less primate. And as you move in that place, and you are working with a particular plant, the plant that interests you, as maybe the smell you like, the taste you like, mm-hmm. something about the plant you like, you have a very good attitude towards this, mm-hmm. and as you quiesce the animal aspects, you find you can start to enter into this communion. Now, rather than say, some people say, well, the spirit of the plant appeared for me is a beautiful woman in radiant gold or green. Some people feel that connection. Some people may hear kind of a voice, a sound, a smell. Some people may just have an intuitive feel for this and just know what it is without going through a rational, logical process and so on. There's no right way and there's no wrong way. It's very, very personal. But to do this, we have to kind of move closer to being a plant in that sense, you know? So, and when you do that, that takes a period, and it's very difficult for Westerners to do that. Not saying it's difficult to do that, but you know, you have to kind of get used to the rainforest jungle conditions a bit. You have to be okay with having no contact, social contact, eating very, very bland foods, very, very basic, non-spicy, non-stimulating foods. But if you're really willing to do this and have a good attitude for this, yeah, it'll work for you. But it's not. It's it takes time to kind of detune our animal characteristics and move closer to this kind of plant mind and so on. And don't forget, at the same time, you are actively engaged with this particular plant. It's called a diet, which you wish to kind of enter into a communion in the true sense of the word, you know, not the religious sense, a meeting of minds, meeting of consciousness and so on. And then the plant can help you, the plant will inform you. So this is what shamans do in the rainforest. They work extensively with plants. They diet these plants for a period from 3 months to a year with a particular plant, and then the plant will help them for healing. The plant, the consciousness, will provide them. Now, in the West, we have a herbalistic tradition, but that's more in the sense of so many volumes and weights and prescriptions and dosage and so on. And it's more seen from a medicinal perspective. If you look at the batch flower remedies, that's very shamanic. That connects much more to the kind of the traditional knowledge, traditional communion with the plants, that the plant has other qualities and so on. So I would think a batch remedy practitioner who's really involved with this will find a lot of correspondences, you know, a lot to learn, a lot to gain from the studying or being involved in the Amazonian plant medicine, where it's a living tradition and so on and so forth. And yeah, we have in the West, we have in our Western culture, Paracelsus. And he was very shamanic, you know, he understood, he had a perspective that the divine, God, the universe, has provided humanity with all the medicines it needs. And not only that, the plant will actually show you, tell you by the signature, signatures, that this is the plant. And it's not a fanciful notion. I mean, this notion. And in the Amazon, for example, they've never heard of Paracelsus, never heard of this doctrine and signatures. But it plays a major role. And there's a plant called Yergon Sacher. And the stem, it's a bush. The stem of this bush has the same pattern as one of the most venomous snakes in the Amazon, the bushmaster. It is really a deadly poison. And not only is it a deadly poison, the snake itself is aggressive. Most snakes, they hear a human come along, they get out of the way, because we are dangerous to them. No, wind of a human, they're out of the way. Except this snake. This snake will stand its ground, it's very territorial, and if you ignore the warning signs, or you know, it will chase you, and it's very fast, and it can bite you at 15 feet, about 3 meters. It can bite you from there in one lunge, and it's fatal. Now there is this plant which has the identical markings of this snake, and the root for this plant is the anti-venom for this snake bite. Yeah, if you in time enough, and people keep these roots, they're kind of like a large flat root, they keep it around just in case. You take the root, you make a poultice of the root, and you place the poultice from the root on the wound, and you're saved, you know. And the difficult thing with anti-venom vaccines is that you need refrigeration, you need power supplies to keep it cool and so on. But there we are, here we have the doctrine of signatures personified in a plant which looks exactly the same as the most deadly snake in the area, and it saves your life, it can cure you. So I mean, that's an example. I mean, that's it's a
yes, it's not the only one. I read in some of in your papers about the strawberries, which are the excellent for the heart, because they look alike. It is the same.
Yeah, that was a different paper. And I was looking at some common fruits and so on.
Common fruits,
and
yes.
They have found recently that there are compounds, and I'm not prepared to give you the, exact chemical. The compounds in the strawberry are very, very useful for prevent heart disease and so on and so forth. And I was making the observation. Hold on, doesn't the strawberry look like the heart? You know, kind of thing. And that's another example. But Paracelsus really was the founder of that whole way of thinking in the West. You know, and you can look at systems such as homeopathy, which really are informed from this. You know, and homeopathy is real energy medicine. You know, is the mineral, the compound, the plant. It's not just a physical component of this. It's the energy which does the healing.
Energy.
You know, the energy,
yeah.
The energy of this material, and the energy is a benign field of energy which enters into your field of energy as you're taking it down, and it changes and shifts and so on. I know homeopathy is extremely difficult for rational, logical-minded people to understand. How can something which contains a minute dose of something heal you? Yeah, but it's not about that. It's about a field of energy, a consciousness, which shifts you. And homeopathy works. I mean, I'm not saying homeopathy works. I'm not a missionary for homeopathy. I just know it works. Personally, I know it works and so on. And off through observation. So yeah, so we have this kind of medicine, you know, dressed up in different languages and different kind of white coats or whatever. But it's still there, you know. But in the Peru and the Amazon, there are no white coats and dressing up and attempts to make it kind of acceptable to the kind of orthodox medical system or the institutions, logical, rational, and so on and so forth. It's just what it is. And that's the reason why. And I've answered this question a very long way around, but that's what drew me and that's what interested me in that area.
It is very hard to me not to ask you about the ayahuasca.
Yeah, you can ask me about that. Yeah.
Yes, because it is a very puzzling for me. All the rituals around the ayahuasca and why ayahuasca we discover in our science, in our positive science, that the compound from ayahuasca only in 1950s, if I know.
That's right. That's correct. I mean, now let me tell you what ayahuasca is. Ayahuasca is the name of the vine. Banistoporus, and it's the name of the mixture, the Banistoporus with the Chacruna, Psychiatra Vidiris, which produced the brew ayahuasca. So it can be a bit confused in terminology. So I don't want to go into too much detail. Ayahuasca is a mixture of a minimum of two plants, and the vine itself acts as an inhibitor, you know. And what we now know as the Maui, the monoamine antioxidant inhibitor, which allows the tryptamines in the chacruna to be not be absorbed by the body. You can't take tryptamines orally because the body enzymes would immediately neutralize this. So the vine acts as an inhibitor, which prevents the body from absorbing these compounds in the leaf.
And without the inhibitor, the effect is isn't.
I'm not saying there's no effect because the ayahuasca has effect as well. There's a different kind of effect. The ayahuasca vine by itself, but the tryptamines, DMT, in the leaves of the chacruna will be immediately utilized. And so the questions. You just think about this for a few minutes. How did they know? I mean, this Maui, the monoamine antioxidant inhibitor, was only discovered in Western science in the 1950s. So it's a recent thing in our scientific understanding. But they've known about this for thousands of years. And not only that, there are already known over 45,000 different plant species in the Amazon. So ask yourself the question, how do they know to combine this plant and that plant? I mean, you know, and the combinations, the possible combinations of 45,000 plants are astronomical. I don't know, I haven't calculated it at all, but I mean, we're talking trillions of possible combinations, you know, this plant, that plant, this plant. And That's a mystery. Mm-hmm. But when you ask them, you say, hey guys, how did you know about this? Well, you know, in the old days, our grandfathers, they met and they then so on. And the plants told them.
The plants said, told
mix
them.
This plant with that plant. Do this and do this. That they directly give it attribution mm-hmm. to the plants informing the people, you know, that of what to do with the plants. Now, I don't think it can be discovered by chance. You know, I'm also open for other possibilities, such as the dreams. You know, dreams have been very informative. I mean, the whole example with the discovery of organic chemistry, the benzene mm-hmm. ring, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. by the German scientist whose name I can't quite remember. DNA. Mm-hmm. DNA. Mm-hmm. Crick and Watson describe yes. a dream they had, or mm-hmm. one of them had, which mm-hmm. he saw that the spiral turned around, and that explained the structure mm-hmm. of the DNA. Mm-hmm. So there's another kind of a source of knowledge or wisdom which mm-hmm. is outside mm-hmm. the rational mind. So it doesn't really matter mm-hmm. where you define it. It's clear there is some kind of a external kind of consciousness which we can connect to at times mm-hmm. in our dreams, in our waking, and so on, which informs us. And I'm very, you know, although they say the plants told us, you can take that literally, metaphorically, and so on. Mm-hmm. But it didn't come through experimenting with 46,000 different types of plants.
And we cannot say that this came by chance. It is impossible to find the exact combination by chance.
It's not impossible, no. Mm. It's not impossible, but it's improbable.
Improbable, okay, yes.
Impossible, improbable. No. Improbable, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, 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 mm-hmm. yeah. So that's a kind of a mystery. But people should ask these questions a bit. People don't ask these questions, but people mm-hmm. should ask these questions a bit. Mm-hmm. How? Why? How do they know this? So this plant and that plant and so on. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there is some obviously empirical studies. I mean, see, ayahuasca is also used. I mean, we have a kind of we give it a visionary context for transformative shifts and so on mm-hmm. and changing your life. Mm-hmm. But also out there, it's really seen as a medicine. You know, I mean, medicine. You know, ayahuasca. Is a very good cleansing for the liver. Mm-hmm. In the Amazon, there's all sorts of problems with parasites and all sorts of other things mm-hmm. that can make people really ill, and mm-hmm. you can drink ayahuasca, mm-hmm. and that will purge the physical body mm-hmm. of mm-hmm. parasites and bacteria and so on. And I'm speaking personally from this, I'm some personal experience of this, I won't go into the details, because it's pretty grotesque details, mm-hmm. but you know, yeah. Mm-hmm. yeah. I had a problem, and it was only resolved, physical problem, and I went to the hospital, everything. I was in Peru at the time, you know, to get this thing sorted out. Ayahuasca cleared it in one evening, boom, you know.
In one evening?
One evening, this thing, yeah. Yeah. It just flushed this out of me, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. And, you know, and I was in a very bad situation. And ayahuasca just, it was a physical healing, cleansing, and it fixed it. So, mm-hmm. yeah.
What about the emotional level, on the emotional level, ayahuasca put us in contact with us, with our emotion, with our wounds?
Good question, you know, I mean, only last Sunday, I was at the Mind Body Spirit mm-hmm, Festival in mm-hmm, Bucharest. Mm-hmm. I was doing a talk about plants mm-hmm, and so on and so mm-hmm. forth. And after the talk, someone came out, approached me, I was outside. Can you tell me about what is ayahuasca? Well, look, I've only got a few minutes, I can only tell you, to be very brief. Mm-hmm. Ayahuasca is about healing. Mm-hmm. Ayahuasca is about purging illnesses, physical mm-hmm. illnesses, and emotional pain and wounds. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, I've spoken to a few friends of mine, this person said, and they all had visions of hell. Mm-hmm. I said, yeah, mm-hmm. but, you know, they weren't visions of an external objectified hell, they were visions, experiences within themselves, of their own pain, of their own wounds, of their own terror, of their own things which are so terrible that a person has to carry around. And I can tell, and I told the person, and I bet you that after these visions of hell, quote, mm-hmm. quote, mm-hmm. they had a massive purging, throwing up, a vomiting. Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, they did. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's what's going on. The ayahuasca was helping that person mm-hmm. to eliminate, to purge, you know, some of the terrors and fears and horrible things that people have, you know. And but as it's being released, as it's being purged, you feel it. You feel it. There's no shortcut here. There's no way around this. You have to feel it. So it's important to say that I'm not somebody who suggests that ayahuasca is appropriate for everybody. Mm-hmm. If you can't, some people can't deal with some of the pain, their wounds, you know. Mm-hmm. And ayahuasca can be very, very, very powerful for it. You know, they need to be looked after around this and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if that's the power of ayahuasca, you know, it really, really can heal you. I mean, the soul healing, the physical healing, and so on. But healing, deep healing, you know, is always, well, you have your own view on this, but my view, mm-hmm. deep healing is always raw. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Mm-hmm. You really are dealing with some stuff, some pain.
Yes.
It's raw. Mm-hmm. And so you have to be ready, yeah, mm-hmm. to do that. Now, that's why I would never tell somebody, you should drink ayahuasca. Mm-hmm. It's not for me. Mm-hmm. If it's the person to feel...
You have to be prepared, yes.
Now I feel drawn to this. Now could be the time for me to transform myself, to heal myself, to release myself of this pain I've been living all my life, you know. Mm-hmm. It's not for another person to tell that. It's a personal mm-hmm. thing, and so on.
Hearing you, I was thinking that, in fact, this is the deep psychotherapy with plants. Plants, the psychotherapist, it's ayahuasca. Hmm? And the changes are remarkable. I understand. You feel it in your emotional body, and it is it don't have to take 7 years of psychotherapy. No, the changes can be felt after one session, maybe.
Maybe, but maybe not.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This depends.
You know, I certainly wouldn't suggest that one session with ayahuasca is going to mm-hmm. heal your life. You know, I mean, for a start, you have to get used to it. Your mm-hmm. body has to adapt to it a little mm-hmm. bit. You know, you have to kind of feel comfortable with it, feel secure with it, and mm-hmm. so on. You know, so it has the potential mm-hmm. for deep, deep healing. Yes.
In fact, what's mean one session of ayahuasca? In what consists a session of ayahuasca?
Well, a session of ayahuasca is drinking a dose of ayahuasca mm-hmm. in one evening, for example. Mm-hmm. You know, with a shaman there and so on, who's doing the chanting and kind of supervision of what's going on and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. But the first time, your body may need some adjustment to it, some physical adjustment to it. Mm-hmm. It doesn't taste very nice, mm-hmm. and people need to get through certain, you know, maybe some difficulties in actually, listen, if you know you are going to face the deepest raw wounds that you have, yeah, mm-hmm. it does take courage, you know, it mm-hmm. does take an element of strength as well, you know, courage, I'll say, you know, and so it's normal for people in their first session to kind of, you know, have to deal with some of the issues around facing the unknown. And I've drunk ayahuasca relatively a large amount, relatively speaking, but every time I drink ayahuasca, I still enter the unknown. I have no idea what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. I don't know, you know, it's the unknown, it's mm-hmm. the mystery. And so when you drink ayahuasca, in many respects, you are facing the mystery, you are facing mm-hmm. the unknown. So a lot of people mm-hmm. will take a bit of time to get used to that action, the act of facing mm-hmm. the unknown, which we don't normally face in our mm-hmm. lives. We live in the lives, things are pretty much known. Mm-hmm. You know, we know where how to get to places, we know where to buy things, we know where to get food, mm-hmm. we know where to get shelter, we know things. But if you're in a situation where you are facing a totally different terrain, facing the unknown, it takes courage. And so, in my observation, you know, it's not a hard and fast rule, just observation, you know, I think people need to drink ayahuasca at least three times, for to go through the stages of facing mm-hmm. the unknown and being open enough to really to be able to release whatever needs to be released and so on, by facing visions of not just visionary experiences but certainly physical experiences, which mm-hmm. are very challenging. Mm-hmm. That's one aspect to it as well. The other aspect is ayahuasca is a very, very visionary plant. You have powerful visions. I'm not saying visions using in the optical sense, but visions in a three-dimensional kind of kinesthetic, audio, everything, you know, kind of experience. And these visions can change your life. When you see something, you can understand something which you maybe never understood in your life, which is a problem with you. You may have a kind of a, it may open your way of thinking to a new way of thinking. You may have a different connection, different relationship with people, with the world, and so on. And that can come through powerful vision. Now, visions have huge power. Visions. Not just people's lives are changed by visionary experience, but entire cultures are changed by visionary experiences. I mean, you have to look at the most famous vision of all, St. Paul on the road to Damascus. Yeah, that vision. Paul was actually pursuing and persecuting these naughty Christians. Yeah, and he was the one who saw this, had this vision. It changed his life, and it changed history. Yeah, things begin with a vision. I mean, you look at some famous inspirational people. Martin Luther King, "I have a dream." Well, that's a vision, a dream, you know. So never underestimate a dream, a personal dream, which can shift your life and subsequently affect other people and even change your culture. So there's that aspect to it as well. There is that transformative expansion, thinking, seeing, perceiving in a different way as well. So ayahuasca has a twofold thing. But the essence is healing. Yeah? And if you can release, if you can heal, you can erase the pain, the trauma of the wounds, you will be a different person. You will operate in the world as a different person. You interact with people in a different way. You will be more the authentic you, not the you who's acting on the basis of the wounds or the pain or the trauma. You will be you. And that alone by itself is a magnificent thing to happen. It's a wonderful thing to happen. And that can change other people as well. People see you change, and that they can change too, you know. And also the transformative vision as well. So I don't want to kind of narrow it down too much. And as I said, I'm not somebody, even though I've a relatively reasonable amount of experience with ayahuasca and that whole kind of world, I know enough not to tell somebody to go and do it. I help somebody who wants to make a decision, yes, but it's not for me to tell that person.
It takes a lot of courage to deal with your own wounds. It's not for everybody.
Of course it does. I mean, psychotherapy is not for everybody. You know, I mean, a lot of people, and it's not, I'm not saying with any judgment, yeah? I mean, with compassion. You know, a lot of people can't face their pain. They can't face the betrayal, the rejection, the whatever it is they've suffered in their life. They can't face it. And it's kind of erased. Suppressed, repressed, whatever you want to call this, it's erased, but it's still there. It's still there. It's still manifest in their life. Even though they may have disconnected from it, it's still there. They still operate on that program. I'm using a terrible computer analogy here, but they're still operating that program, you know. If they can release this, if they can shift this pain and stop living their life based on this pain, they will be the authentic individual, you know. I mean, where'd you begin with this? Where'd you begin with this? I mean, in our culture, you know, and I think, and I'm making a judgmental comment here, but I think it's disgraceful that we are regarded as being born in sin. We are sinners.
Yes.
Yeah? Now, you and I in the 21st century may think, oh, that's just some kind of a religious doctrine, blah, blah, blah. But whether you believe, accept it or not, it's affected our entire lives. You know, we're not good enough. You know, how can you think you are doing this? You know, you have to have qualifications, exams. You have to kind of you have to a huge amount of effort to kind of to build a facade to say, you know, I'm good. I'm not a sinner anymore, or I can justify my actions and activities and so on. And this all comes from that place of weakness, that place of you know, being a sinner. So whether or not you subscribe to that particular belief is irrelevant, because it's affected all of us, and that's a kind of a kind of a cultural, you know, Terence McKenna. Said our culture is our operating system.
Yes, our operating system.
And that's what it is, we're sinners, and so on and so forth. And not only sinners, we are we have dominion over all living things, and we, you know, and that's why we treat the world like an industrial resource and the natural world, and as you know, we eat animals, we eat cows, we eat horses, we eat pigs, we eat everything, you know. And where is the consciousness in this? Where is the consciousness? Excuse me, we're just these are living things. Living things. What are we doing here, you know? That thing is just wiped out, erased. Like our pain is erased. A potentially compassionate view on the world around us is also erased. And it's only sustainable by the culture we have created. As a collective we've created and sold, you know. And medicines like ayahuasca, you know, and all hallucinogenics in that respect, you know, are a challenge to the materialistic consciousness, the institutions, and whatever it is, the commercial interests and activities and so on, because it takes us out of that kind of cultural, materialistic mindset where our personal worth, our personal value, which has been damaged already from the original sin, is only supported or kind of shown, displayed by the accumulation of material goods, big cars, whatever it is, and so on and so forth. So we are acting from as a society from a traumatic place, you know. And medicines like ayahuasca and other hallucinogenics can take us out of that particular cultural tunnel which we came into. You see, that's the problem. We came into that into this culture. Without any terms of reference, this is how it is, you know.
Yeah.
And things like ayahuasca, plants like ayahuasca, medicines like this, can take us out of that.
Yes,
and that's why it's interest. Threatening to the. That's why it's become illegal and blah 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 and difficult. So cognitive independence and freedom has been denied to us because it's a threat to the a kind of materialistic consciousness, the money, the business, the governments, and so on and so forth. And but that's nothing new. That shift has been going on since the 1960s. You know, the things have been shifting slowly, and as more and more people become interested, involved, and participate, and so on. That's gonna you know, that's gonna kind of slowly grow. It has to grow slowly and organically, and in my view it's growing in some respects because that's what the consciousness of the plants wants to happen. Now's the time for it.
Because we only have 8 minutes left. Can you tell us about your experience, personal experience with Pablo Amaringo?
Pablo, Pablo died in 2009, but he was no, I feel emotional even thinking about Pablo. He's a beautiful man, not just a beautiful man, not just just oozing with eclectic knowledge that how can somebody who lives in a small place in the Amazon rainforest know about? You know, I mean, he knew about things. I had to go and research to get them validated. But Pablo was had a beautiful life story. He had all sorts of challenges and so on and so forth. But he always, had the ability to draw perfectly. He could draw perfectly a banknote. You know how complex banknotes are. He could draw it by hand. By hand, he could draw an exact replica of a banknote, and he did when he was younger, innocently, and he got into trouble for forging money, and he got put in prison, and he escaped in a canoe along the Amazon to Brazil. All sorts of stories. So his whole story is in here. Great story. But and his father and his whole family were shamans. You know, I mean, I'm using the word shaman in a very very loose sense because it's a Western term, comes from Siberia, and there's many specializations of shamans, and so he came from that background. He was born in a very very grew up in a very isolated part of the Amazon, and he started. He became a shaman. He became an ayahuasca hero himself. There's beautiful paintings in this book, you know. He became an ayahuasca hero himself, and he had the ability to remember every single one of his visions. You know, and the thing with Pablo, I want to say is that there are things which we in the West will say. Oh, that's a fantasy, that's a mythological, legendary thing. But some of the stories I'm talking with Pablo when he was young He said, no, I saw this with my very own eyes. I witnessed this with my own eyes. So Pablo was somebody who lived in a world which is not really, is kind of far gone. He lives in a kind of a magical reality, a world where the magical aspects and the everyday aspects were together. Mm-hmm. That's how he grew up in that kind of world. Mm-hmm. And he remembered his visions. Mm-hmm. And Pablo has so much wisdom. You know, working on this book with Pablo was an education experience for me. He was a teacher to me. You know, some of the paintings are very, the meanings are very enigmatic, very abstract, mm-hmm. in some respects very allegorical. And mm-hmm. he would only tell me enough to kind of get me thinking in a certain way. But I would have to go away. I would have to kind of reflect, meditate, be with the painting, be with the picture, but for a period of time before I kind of understood what he was saying. Mm-hmm. I had to kind of get it. And then I could write the narrative for the painting. And when I went to see him, Pablo, this is what I've written about your painting. You get it, you've got it. But I had to get it. Mm-hmm. I had to get it before mm-hmm. I could write it. And his primary, his main thing, the painting he did was apart from the painting by itself. That was his manifestation, his devotion to bringing this consciousness into the world. But it was also to fund a school, Uska Ayar, for young children in the region of the Ukiali River region, to give them an education. You know, to give them education, not just in art, but to get them in spiritual matters, ethics, and so on and so forth. He taught them languages. It was the kind of thing that was what the money was for, to provide an education school for the local young children. So that was really important for him. Mm-hmm. And he was a beautiful man, a master. I'm using the word master in the true master. Sense of the word.
Yes.
True sense. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, just being with Pablo just mm-hmm. changed, was affected you in such a nice way. Mm-hmm. And and I'm so honored and privileged, apart from having a friend, you know, and a teacher, but also to do this work. And this book is interesting. You know, I've known Pablo for a long, long time, since late 90s. And I've been collecting his work for some years, but I've never ever had the idea of doing the work about this. You know, I've had an interview published about him and so on. Mm-hmm. But during my ayahuasca session in 2007, mm-hmm. I think, 2007, it was 2007, mm-hmm. The visions I was having were all about Pablo's work. Mm-hmm. And in this experience, the ayahuasca communicated to me and said, mm-hmm. Howard, do a book about Pablo's new work. Wow, you know, hey, you know. And the following day, I was sitting with this thing, this concept, and da 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 da. And by the evening, yeah, I knew the book would happen. Mm-hmm. I knew it would take place, and that was it. I knew it was going to happen. So a little bit later, I went to visit Pablo, and I said, hey, Pablo, blah blah blah, how are you? I had a vision. And ayahuasca told me this, would you like to work with me on a book about your work? And his face lit up completely. And that was it. Then we obviously, it's a book, it's a contractual thing. We signed some memorandums to say we're going to do this, how we're going to do this, how we're going to approach this, and so on. And that was it. And it was a work of beauty for me, a service to Pablo.
A remarkable and anthropological contribution that you have.
Oh, yeah, yeah. There's a lot of interesting stuff there.
Yes.
The thing is, it's a book, and a book has a structure. Mm-hmm. And we had so many paintings to write about, mm-hmm. so we're looking at about 2,000 words per painting. Mm-hmm. But some of those paintings I could have written a book about. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's how much was in there.
Yes.
You know? And I'm so delighted. He's a beautiful man. Mm-hmm. And I'm so delighted to privilege to have communicated his message, his message of spirituality, of wisdom, of ecological wisdom, and so on. That was my service, and at least I know I've done something good in my life. Mm-hmm. You know, that's good to know as well. You know.
And unfortunately, we were in our last minute of the show, and I want you to thank you for your message, which is beautiful, and you are a beautiful person.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you.
And
thank you.
We are very honored that you accepted our invitation. And
hey, I'm very, very happy you invited me. You know, I've recently relocated to Romania, unofficially speaking. I'm sorry, everybody, but no, I am, obviously. Mm-hmm. And I really like it here. I'm in Brasov. I really enjoy Brasov. I enjoy the mountain air. And I really find the Romanian people very, very open. You know, a lot of openness here and interest in the work I'm doing. And a lot of friendliness as well. So I feel really comfortable being here, you know, talking to you and being present here. So, you know, I'll be doing more work here as well, more events and things. And so.
Thank you again.
Thank you for inviting me. I really appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you. It's been a pleasure to be here. Thank you. Thank you.
Poate știi să spui sternocleidomastoidian, dar sigur nu l-ai văzut niciodată în realitate. Vino la incredibila expoziție The Human Body, care a lăsat peste 20 de milioane de vizitatori din toată lumea cu cavis orali deschisă. Vezi ce n-ai văzut niciodată în oglindă. Dedesubturile corpului uman în peste 200 de exponate, corpuri umane reale, o perspectivă tridimensională fidelă a țesuturilor și organelor, plus informații impresionante despre funcțiile lor. Doar la expoziția The Human Body. Până pe 30 iunie la Muzeul Grigore Antipa. Bilete în rețeaua Eventim sau la intrare.
Care urmăresc doar desene animate și documentare fascinante sunt mai cuminți. Vino în orice magazin UPC și află cum poți lua telecomanda Techi cadou pentru micuții tăi curioși. Techi, inovația pentru copii.
Iubitele, ghiși ce mi-am luat?
Îți place?
Mă întorc imediat. Am cumpărat o rochie și aș dori să o returnez.
Îmi pare rău, nu se poate.
Cum adică?
Dar ce s-a întâmplat? Vă strânge?
Glumiți, știți cine sunt eu? Sunt cetățean european și am drepturi.
Când cumperi online, ai dreptul să returnezi produsul în 10 zile de la primirea comenzii și să-ți iei banii înapoi. E dreptul tău. Acționează!
Universitatea Spiru Haret. Fii conectat la pulsul unei vieți studențești dinamice. Află noutăți din toate facultățile. Suntem în București, Brașov, Câmpul Lung Mușcel, Craiova, Blaj, Râmnicu-Vâlcea și Constanța. Doar un like și primești informații din toate campusurile noastre. Intră pe Facebook Universitatea Spiru Haret. Merită!
Vine vacanța cu trenul din Franța la Dr. H. De ce este important să acordăm atenție pielii?
Dacă pielea arată rău, indiferent ce am face, și noi vom arăta rău.
Vreau să învățăm un obicei sănătos.
Cei care folosesc constant cremele cu factor de protecție solară ar putea avea un deficit. Motoul nostru este într-adevăr o întâlnire între frumusețe și sănătate.
Dumnezeu ne-a lăsat pe pământ să mâncăm din toate câte puțin.
În fiecare dimineață începeți cu un zâmbet că vine vacanța și e de bine în vacanță.
La prima vedere, Graciela Graci Alonso pare a fi o adolescentă obișnuită care se mută într-un oraș nou. Dar, dacă te uiți cu atenție, vei vedea că numai obișnuită nu este. Graci nu știe încă, dar lucrurile misterioase care se întâmplă